Well, today I'm talking to Jenna Evans Welch, who is the New York Times bestselling author of Love and Gelato, a Netflix movie. Her new book, Spells for Lost Things. And I'm wearing my lilac to accent the book.
I bought a pair of purple Converse sneakers, but that was that's the only purple I have in my closet.
You need to reward yourself with those.
I know. As soon as I saw the cover, I bought them.
So let's talk first about Love and Gelato, because was that even in your consciousness? Like, did you write it and think, I want this to become a movie?
You know, honestly,
and be honest.
There was always a secret hope, right? Like, wouldn't that be amazing? Books have always been my main focus and the thing that I care about most, but I always thought, wouldn't that be cool? I actually had it on my vision board for a couple of years, so it was kind of fun to see it actually come together. So yes, it was always there for me. But then when it came down to it, I really just turned it over to filmmakers and watched what they did with it, which was exciting.
It's pretty amazing. I mean, when you watch it, what the first time you watched it, what was it like?
It was really surreal. It was real. I mean, just watching characters I'd made up across the screen. I don't really know how to describe it. It was a very, very weird experience and very exciting.
Yeah, I would imagine it would be. I was checking out your Instagram page, and you have I think it's on Instagram. You have you walking by a number of different titles to your books, and it looks like they're in Italian.
So I went on book tour to Brazil this year.
Oh, wow.
And so that was in Brazil. I was at a conference there, and it is so funny. My books have been enormous there, honestly. And I kind of knew that was going on, but I didn't realize I'd be like recognized in public or need security guards. It was the craziest experience of my life.
it looked so cool. I mean, you could just see the shock and awe in your eyes walking by.
Like, what is this?
So let's talk about your new book. Who knows? This may be the next movie. I guess let's tell me the storyline. Let's talk about the storyline, the two characters first.
Sure. Yeah. So it's two characters. It's a YA contemporary novel, and it's got, you know, it dips its toe into magic, but it's firmly contemporary. It's not fantasy. So Willow is a young woman who is feeling estranged from her family. Her parents have divorced, have built entirely different lives, and she feels kind of lost in the world. And so her plan is she has wanderlust. She's going to go out into the world and she's going to see everything. And while she's out there, she's going to find someplace that feels like home to her. Mason has been in foster care off and on for about 10 years. He's been placed in a new foster home in Salem, Massachusetts, and he is obsessed with stargazing. It's something that comes with him no matter where he is. Yeah. And he really, really wants to be reunited with his mother. So the two of them collide in Salem, Massachusetts, where Willow has recently learned that her mother has a twin who her mother had never told her about, and also who has since passed away, and also who may or may not have been a witch. And so she's kind of learning about her mother, about a potential family curse, and the two of them start to work together and start to build a new concept of home.
Where do you get those ideas? Like, where does it come from? I know your imagination, but like, where does it really come from?
That is such a good question. I try to remember that, you know, with each of my books, I feel like I've gotten like a couple of kernels that I don't know where it came from. And it just was kind of a little gift, right? A gift from the creativity muses or whatever it is. And then the rest, I just work really, really hard. All of my books that I've written over and over and over until I ended up with something that I was excited about. This book, Spells for Lost Things, during the height of the pandemic, I had some friends who said, let's do a full moon circle. And let's start gathering at the full moon, and we'll like talk about magic. And it turned out to be just my favorite thing. We had so much fun. We learned how to cast spells over Zoom, which was hilarious. So it was this like fun thing I was doing with my girlfriends. We were learning how to read tarot.
Yes.
And I was like, this is definitely going to end up in a book because this is too fun. So that was the spark.
Oh my gosh, you lived it. That's the thing. Sometimes life itself is just so random. And I've talked to other authors who say it's like idea goes by like a cloud and they reach up and grab it. And if they don't stop what they're doing to grab it, it just floats on and another author or another artist reaches up and grabs it. I love the name Willow. I love the name Willow. It fits the character. How did you come up with something as simple as that name? And it's not really, I guess.
Thank you. So part of this story is that Willow learns that all of the women in her family are named after things in a garden. They're all named after flowers and trees. And so Willow has a special meaning in the book. It's also just a name that I really loved. I was calling her something different for most of the writing. And as soon as I realized this missing piece of, oh, all the women in her family have this name, I knew exactly what her name would be. the meaning of her book, or meaning of her name in the book, is that, you know, they're fast growing trees, they're pretty hardy, and they're very flexible. And that's why they survive, right? Able to flow with things and able to move in the wind. And I was just very interested in that concept.
Yes, that is so true. What are some of the themes? Like when a reader picks up this book, what are some of the themes that they might experience in the book?
Well, I'm always trying to balance the fun of a book for kids with heavier issues, because I think that all teens are dealing with their own problems. So I took a course by R.L. Stine, one of those master classes, and he said, books for kids need to be fun. You know, they need to make you laugh. Like, kids are always laughing. They're trying to have fun. So I always try to keep that in mind while also addressing, you know, kind of the heavier topics, bringing them together. So this book is a lot about family relationships. It's about a mother and child relationship. There's some themes about addiction, about forgiveness, friendship, and
not fitting in.
There's a lot of that, not fitting in, loneliness, and also just kind of looking for home.
Yeah. And even if you're different, you know, there's somebody else out there that's different too. And you can still have a beautiful relationship, you know, based on your own respect for each other. Right. I mean, it is a beautiful book. What were you reading when you were a kid? Like when you were that age, what kind of books did you pick up?
I mean, I was reading everything as a child, and I actually decided that I wanted to write for young adults, for teenagers, when I was 11. I was growing up, it was the 90s. And I remember going to my local library, and there was this little shelf, and it was like the teenager books. And I was so disappointed. I didn't feel like they were as fun or engaging or as adventurous as the books that I'd loved so much as a child. So I actually told my mom at 11 that I was going to write books for teenagers. So, you know, I've always had that in mind. And I remember being disappointed. I went from children's books to adult books because there just weren't really the books that I wanted to read. Now the YA market has exploded, and it's incredible. I think I would have just spent all of my teen years in my room reading if I
and probably and who knows, maybe even writing, right?
Yes,
you could have been like the first 11-year-old writing a book. Do you your books have romance in them? Do you remember your first big romance?
Yes, definitely. I think I'm able to access like my teen years pretty easily, and I actually met and fell in love with my husband when I was 17. So it was very much, sometimes I wonder if that's why I'm writing about, you know, young love, because it's still very real and connected to me. And I do think that those young relationships can be important, not just if they last long-term, but also because they just help you learn so much about yourself.
Yeah. And you're going through the journey with somebody else, you know, you're traveling the journey. What advice would you have like for young readers, just maybe them trying to navigate their first big romance?
And I think that, you know, the young years, it's so important to take care of yourself, right? Mm-hmm. That just trying to get to know themselves, making sure they feel comfortable in all situations. I also think giving yourself room to make mistakes, knowing that you don't have to be perfect. I don't know, those first relationships can be tricky. And I think it's kind of helpful to know that, you know, we've all kind of been through that.
Yeah.
You're not alone in it.
Yeah. Yeah. I think your books, you know, there's a lot of them are set in exotic locations. And I think it kind of helps the kids too, maybe to start to venture out into the world as well. Right. I mean, how have you been to all of those exotic places or just yes?
Yeah. So I actually went to high school in Florence, Italy, which is where my first novel, Love and Gelato, is set. So, you know, that was a huge deal for me. I had grown up in Salt Lake City, Utah. I hadn't traveled much, and it just expanded my world so, so much. I met kids from all over the world. And so writing about the teen years with travel has made a lot of sense to me, because that was my experience as a young person. Yeah. I do think that travel gives kind of just a unique and quick way to realize how many different ways there are to live.
Right.
And I also think it just makes for really fun reading, really fun stories to explore somewhere new.
Yeah. I mean, it's working for the Hallmark Channel, you know? Right. You know, I was reading where Kirkus Review gave you just said the most beautiful thing, a magical romance with a strong sense of place and a focus on family. And that's kind of what you set out to do, right?
Yeah. All of my books have had like a romance element, but I think those other relationships are just as, if not more important in the teen years. So I'm always interested in exploring all different types of relationships, including family. And sometimes that's great. And sometimes it's not. Sometimes, you know, those relationships can sometimes have things to be desired. And I've tried to explore that as well. You know, when you have relationships that have let you down in some way, I think that's an important thing to work through.
Oh, for sure. What are you working on now?
You know, honestly, I'm releasing this book and I'm taking a little break.
Oh, good for you.
I know, I've been under contract and working hard for the past 8 years, and I just have a moment to pause, and I am living in that pause. I'm baking, I'm taking naps, I'm walking.
And I bet the creative juices are just flowing. Even if you just jot down ideas, I'll get to them later, right?
Exactly. I have a notes, a notes app, and I'm putting down my ideas. And I'm like, not yet.
Do you ever write for pleasure? Just, I'm not talking about like under contract or for somebody. Do you ever just write for pleasure? Just that maybe nobody else is going to see it.
You know, I have really enjoyed writing morning pages. Have you ever heard of morning pages?
No.
So there's a book written by a woman, I think her name is Julia Cameron, and it was written quite a while ago. It was a book written to address like artistic blocks, like writing blocks.
Yes.
And she has a concept where you wake up in the morning and you just write 3 pages, stream of conscious, whatever's on your mind.
Oh, wow.
And it can just help you like move forward with your day. So I have done that off and on for years. So I guess that's like the writing I do that I'm like, I never want anyone to see this, right?
Yes.
Luckily, no one can read my handwriting, but
it's like a purge, right? It's like a purge. That sounds wonderful. That may be my next thing that I'm doing there. Spells for Lost Things. Fabulous book. I've read the reviews. I got it a little late, so I couldn't finish it, but tons of positive reviews. It's so much fun. You can get it at your local bookstore. You can get it online everywhere. And then where can people reach out to you as well, Jenna?
Well, if we're online, I'm on Instagram. That's my main place. I've got a website as well, but both of them are under Jenna Evans Welch.
JennaEvansWelch.com. Hey, thank you so much for talking with me. Good luck. Enjoy your relaxation and inspiration time.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you for talking to me today.